That's exactly what I was trying to do, to understand what it's like to manage the problem of being disliked
right.
if you're a very large corporation. And so one of the things that I discovered was, of course, these are all smart people, and they think about this in a sophisticated way. And they ask themselves, for example, okay, how can we fix this problem? And one way to do it would be to look into history for some golden age of oil industry popularity where you could kind of model a strategy.
Yeah.
Well, they do that and they say, actually, there isn't one, okay? All the way back to the standard oil breakup in 1911.
Yeah.
And then another way to think about the problem, which is I think where they have often come out, is they ask themselves, why does it matter? Why does it matter whether we're disliked? And to some extent, it's sort of reassuring to tell yourself after you ask that question, it doesn't much. Mm. And I wonder whether that's correct looking ahead, because the world that they're competing in is tougher and tougher, and they need great talent. And you look at young people today coming up in the sciences or in engineering, you look at the diversity of the world's talent. Are they really going to be able to recruit and retain the very best and the brightest if their culture is closed and if their reputation is such that when a young scientist goes home for Thanksgiving dinner and tells his cousins where he works, there's a sort of sucking in of breath, you know? You know what I mean? Whereas if you go home and say, I work for Apple, everyone's like,
tell us about what it's like. Yeah. There is this also, the notion that they, as a company, want to maximize their profits. Mm. And that, therefore, they want to, in a sense, rather than look and find alternative sources of energy and develop them and spend money on them, that they really want to maintain the dominance of fossil fuel.
Well, you did in 2005, I think, the best interview that's ever been done with the dominant chief executive of ExxonMobil's recent era, a guy named Lee Raymond, you may know. And you did a fantastic two-hour interview, which was a foundation of my early reporting. And Lee Raymond, I think, said to you, but also said in a couple of other settings, that he wanted to go to the corporate headquarters of ExxonMobil and find a granite plaque and emblazon on it the words crude oil to remind everybody what business they were in. And I think there's still a kind of corporate culture of purism. And they take a pride in it in comparison, say, for example, to BP's strategy during the sort of Tony Blair era. Remember when BP rebranded itself just BP, no reference to petroleum, and they had a picture of a sun with green sort of trim on it. And the ExxonMobil...
To the derision of some of their competitors.
Well, and most emphatically ExxonMobil, which did point out that BP's revenues were still 98% or so derived from oil and gas.
Exactly.
But the question is, okay, you're an oil and gas purist, granted. Is this a viable strategy for the next 50 or 70 years? And they spend a fair amount of time analyzing that. I think they've come to one conclusion that does mark a partial change of direction. Some of it's been forced upon them, some of it they've chosen, which is they're pushing toward gas much more than before. And partly that's because of the explosion of opportunity onshore in the continental United States with unconventional gas, so-called. And what's attractive to them about that, given how hard it is to own oil and gas in so much of the world because of resource nationalism, as we were talking about earlier, in the United States, property rights are sacrosanct. Everybody can own whatever they can buy. So if you can beat the regulatory impediments, at least the question of nationalism does not arise. You can actually own what you can find.
Join us online at charlierose.com.